Thank you very much. Thanks a lot for the invitation to this workshop. Unfortunately, as the previous speaker said, I couldn't attend due to some teaching duties. So today I would like to discuss with you a way of computing amplitudes on ADS spacetimes using the ADS-CFT correspondence and in particular the CFT side of the correspondence. So what I'm going to discuss is mostly based on a few papers that I wrote with my PhD student, Giulia Fardelli, a postdoc at NordIT, Alessandro Georgiutis, and a postdoc here at Uppsala, Andrea Manenti. So as I said, the goal is to use the ADS-CFT correspondence together with the conformal bootstrap to be able to construct amplitude in ADS. So in the next slide, I will try to motivate why it is hard to compute amplitudes in ADS and maybe also why it is interesting to compute amplitudes in ADS. When I talk about amplitude, I mean scattering amplitudes. So the plan is to review a bit the method, so how one can go from using the conformal bootstrap in the context of the ADS-CFT correspondence. We heard a bit about the conformal bootstrap, so I won't do the introduction. We heard a couple of talks back. And then I would like to discuss a bit the structure of amplitudes at all loops. I'm going to discuss what all loop means, and then I'm going to discuss a bit how to extend it and what can be new directions and open problems. Okay, so let me start with something very simple, so or at least simpler than the problem that I would like to discuss. So the idea is to compute scattering amplitudes in string theory in flat space. So the way in which if you work in string theory, you have been studying this problem is to start here. I depicted a four point amplitude. So when we have two particles that we scatter into two other particles. And if we look at this process, as I said, in string theory, we know that we can organize this kind of expansion in as a genus expansion. So I wrote here a couple of diagrams, three diagrams. So here we have the first order diagram, then we have the one loop and the two loops and so on. And you see that each term can be written in terms of ST and U, which are the Mandelson variables, which are related essentially to the momenta of the incoming and the outgoing particles. And then alpha prime, which is, I'm going to discuss in a second what it is, but it is one of the string parameters. So in particular, as we see here, this, the first order, which is the order at genus zero is a full function of alpha prime and as I said of the Mandelson variables. So let's look a bit to this term. So if we look a bit to this term, this takes this form, which is the so-called Virasoro-Shapiro amplitude. So you see here that there are some specific poles at some values of ST and U, which are, as I said, the Mandelson variables. So the idea that I would like to give at the end of this talk and through the talk itself is how to study this kind of expansion and this kind of object when we go, instead of being in flat space, when we go to curved space and in particular to the ADS space. So now if we would expand the amplitude that I wrote before when alpha prime is small. So we see that the first term looks like this way. So we have one over ST and U, and then we have a full expansion in alpha prime. And you see that actually this kind of expansion is reminiscent on the low energy expansion of the string action. And you see that the first order corresponds to the supergravity term, and then we have all the higher derivative corrections. And we will see that actually this is what also happens when we go to curved space. But let me go a bit slower. So how do we go from flat to curved space? Imagine that we would like to do by using the usual Feynman diagram techniques. We just write down the action has been written down, and then we can read off the vertices and compute the corresponding width and diagrams that correspond to the vertices that we would like to compute. And the problem with if we would like to pursue this route is the fact that there are thousands of diagrams and there is not a manifest principle to group them. What it means? It means that we need to compute all of them and there is no way out to that. So in particular, some of the amplitudes have been computed using this method, but as soon as you start discussing external like amplitudes of objects which are a bit more complicated, meaning some spinning particles, or if you go a bit higher in the expansion that I showed you before, when a bit higher means one loop, which is genus one, it's already extremely complicated. So what I would like to discuss is an alternative way. The alternative way is based on the fact that we can use the dual CFT description to study in this particular talk amplitudes or gravitons or gluons toward the very end of this talk in a GS and an alpha prime expansion. The idea is to use the symmetries, as we heard in the previous talk, and instead in my talk, in addition to the conformal symmetry, I will also add the supersymmetry, which indeed is important in this description. And we will see that by using this symmetry, we can compute or constrain the full amplitude of graviton and of gluons. So, as I said, the idea is to use the ADS-CFT correspondence. So, in the ADS-CFT correspondence, we know that type 2B superstring theory on ADS5 cross S5 is related to four-dimensional N=4 superior Mills with SUN gauge group and an SU4 R symmetry group. And in particular, now that it come back, the parameters that I was discussing before, we have this GS, which, as we saw before, it labels the genus expansion. And we also have alpha prime, which is related to the string length, which is essentially, we saw before when I was discussing a bit the small alpha prime limit, that it counts essentially the higher derivative expansion that we have. But this is on the ADS side. When we go to the CFT side, we have the rank of the gauge group N, and we have the coupling of the superior Mills, which is GM Mills. And we see that actually the ADS-CFT correspondence relates also these parameters, and in particular, N, the rank of the group, is related to this string coupling. So remember that we would like to mimic that kind of expansion. So I would like to use this CFT side to talk about the genus expansion. So I need to take, since before we were taking a G as a small GS expansion in order to do the genus expansion, we need now to take a larger expansion on the CFT side. And in particular, also, if we want to take the alpha prime limit, which was the one that I showed before, we can introduce the top coupling constant, this lambda here, which is related to GM Mills and then through this relation here. And then we can take lambda to be large, and then we will mimic the alpha prime expansion. So the idea of this talk is essentially to take a large N expansion and a large lambda expansion in order again to focus on the object that I was showing before in flat space. So again, the idea is to take these correlators, and so since we are talking about conformal field theory, the way in which we can compute correlators is again through the ADS-CFT correspondence. So we have these points which are located on the boundary, and then we can read off the amplitude. Now, as I said before, I will be interested in discussing amplitudes of gravitons. So we would like to understand what are the object or the operator on the CFT which are mapped into the gravitons. And the operator which belong to the same supermultiplet of the operator which is dual to the graviton, which is the stress tensor, is a single trace protected half VPS operator, which is of this form here. In particular, the one that is dual to the stress tensor is when this P here is equal to 2. And you see that the dimension of this object, which is completely non-renormalizable, which means that it doesn't acquire any quantum correction, is equal to 2, and it transforms under the SUN, under the SU4 R symmetry under this representation here. In particular, we will see later that we cannot avoid also talking about, despite the fact that we are interested in those operators, we cannot avoid discussing the full class of operator when P is generic. Okay, so this is what I said. So the P equal to 2 is the stress tensor, which is dual to the graviton. And then when we have P greater than 2, we have all the Kaluza-Klein modes. So at the end of the day, what we are interested in? We are interested in this four-point correlator. Notice that in addition to the space-time variables X, I'm also introducing another set of variables, which are this Y, which denotes also the SU4 R symmetry representation under which this operator transform. So the idea is to discuss this four-point correlator when this operator here is a scalar operator which is protected, and this is a single trace operator, the one that I show you before. So as I mentioned, we can take off. So here I'm just using essentially conformal symmetry in addition to these extra variables that are just important to understand which kind of operator I'm dealing with. And then we have this function here. This is again dictated only by conformal symmetry. And this function here is a function of the cross ratios U and V, which are just a combination of the positions, and of this object sigma and tau, which are called harmonic cross ratios, which are a combination of the Ys. So you can see again from here that this four just comes because we are considering external operator which have dimension 2. Now, this function here can be seen being a polynomial in sigma and tau. It's not extremely important in this talk, but I'm using, just for people that might have seen this object, I'm using the convention in which this function g is a polynomial in sigma and tau. So now what can we do here? Here we start with, as I said before, operators which are protected due to the supersymmetry. So the idea now would be to understand which kind of operator we are exchanging in the when we take the operator product expansion between these two objects and these two other operator here. So in particular, what we would like to do when we take the operator product expansion of two protected operators, we will have a class of operators which will still be protected by supersymmetry, which means that the dimension of this operator and the three-point function of this operator and two of such operators is also protected, and then we will have another class of operator which are the unprotected operator, which will be the one that are interesting to us because they are completely completely on the dynamics of the theory. So it will be the object that will be hard and they are more interesting to be constrained and to be computed. So in order to do this splitting here, to split the protected side from the unprotected side, we can use the superconformal world identities. And by using the superconformal world identities to such four-point function, we can disentangle the contribution of the protected operator. I wrote here just how to do this object, but this is just to mention why we are interested in doing that. So the idea again is to isolate the contribution of the protected operator. So after doing that, we can split our four-point correlator in two pieces. One function, which again, denotes the contribution of the short protected operator, and another object, which instead takes into account the contribution of the unprotected operator. So this function here can be completely computed, and can be completely computed because we can use the conformal block decomposition of this four-point correlator. And as I said, if the operator is protected, we know all the dimension and all the three-point or the OP coefficients, so we can just compute this full function here, or we can also use the superconformal world identities to just find this function g here, which is nothing but a combination So when we rewrite this, when we write this kind of constraint, we can reformulate in terms of this G short here. Now we will be interested in instead computing this A delta L and this delta, which comes from the OP decomposition of from the conformal block decomposition of this function H long, which intrinsically depend on the coupling constant in general, because it's a fully dynamical quantity. Notice that I didn't mention at all the fact that this full function is also a function of n, which is the rank of the gauge group. And in particular, g short and h long will both depend on n, but only h long will instead depend on lambda, where lambda is the Toft coupling that I was introducing before. This object here is the superconformal block, this function GS, but it is nothing that a combination of the usual conformal block. So I don't want to spend much time on that. So the idea again is to mimic this expansion that we were doing before in terms of the genus expansion. So in order to do that, we can expand for large n. And we will have again the first, the leading order, which corresponds to the genus zero on the previous side. And then we will have H1, H2, and so on. And again, the idea is to use crossing symmetry and also the knowledge of this function, this protective function, and to use the technology of the conformal bootstrap in the analytic form to construct all these functions here, starting with this object. So the idea is to understand which is the minimum set of information that allows us to compute this full function, which, as I said, depends on the coupling constant. Now, in this talk, I'm going to refer to the leading order in lambda. So here, this function, this full function will also depend on lambda, but I'm restricting myself to the leading order in lambda. Actually, I decided not to discuss that, but it has been completely, I mean, most of it is developed. If you are interested, you can ask me a question later, but I decided to present, not to clutter too much the notation and to introduce too many concepts. Also, we can also take this expansion as a function of lambda. So the idea for people that are familiar with that is that the first order here is just a Witten diagram with the disconnected contribution. Then H1 is this exchange here in quartic vertices, while this H2 is the one loop box diagram. Notice that when we are taking this large an expansion up to this order H2, there are only the intermediate operators, which are the one that are, let me just go quickly back. So when I talk about intermediate operators, are the operators that are inside this sum here. So when we have this delta and L, they denote the dimension, the conformal dimension and the spin of this operator that are inside the OPE. So these kind of operators are only double trace operators, so because the other one, they are just decoupled in this limit here. Notice that when we go instead the higher order in the expansion, there will be also multiple trace, like triple trace and quadruple trace and so on, which starts contributing. But we will see in a second that still we can, by knowing all the double trace operator, we can still find some nice results. Okay, so let me discuss a bit how we can find this OP coefficient. So in order to do that, in order to reconstruct the correlator, it is enough to know the singularities. By singularities, I mean the singularities when we go when we take V going to zero. We have seen in the previous talk this kind of limit already into play, or we can discuss, we can say that we can reconstruct the correlator by its double discontinuity. By double discontinuity, I mean this object that I wrote it here. So the double discontinuity is just the Euclidean correlator, which has been subtracted by these two pieces, which are the analytic continuation around z bar equal to 1. So when we know this object, we can plug into this integral relation when we have essentially the double discontinuity and some kernel here, which again depends on C and Z bar, and then we can read off this object C of delta L. And now you can ask, what is C of delta L? So C of delta L is an object which has poles at the dimension of the exchanged operators, and the residues at these poles are exactly the OP coefficient that I was showing you before. So it is clear that when we know this C delta L, we can completely reconstruct the function because we know both the dimension and the OP coefficient. So we can go back to the formula that I wrote you before and compute that contribution. So now the idea is to understand how, what do we need to know in order to reconstruct this double discontinuity? Because essentially the double discontinuity tells us everything that we need to know in order to reconstruct this full C of delta NL. Okay, so if we go back to our original problem, we can now start expanding. This again is the leaving order. Notice here that I'm already inputting the fact that we have double trace operators. So we have this object, which is, remember that the external operator is dimension 2, so this 4 is the dimension, so here I put the structure, so we have two operator of dimension 2, so 2 plus 2, 4, plus 2n, which is the dimension of the box, plus l, which is the these possible derivatives that we can add, and then the full expansion in terms of correction to the dimension, as when we expand around the large N, and the same we can do for the three-point coupling. So now we can plug this expression into the superconformal block decomposition that I was showing you before to get this kind of expansion. Then you see that as always when we do perturbation theory, we have that for any time that we expand for large N, we pick up a logarithm of U that appears because we have an exponent of, we have U to gamma 1 to N squared plus gamma 2 N to the 4 and so on and so forth. So we will have a log square U when we have the gamma 2 and so on. So now, something that is extremely nice is that at order n to the 0 and 1 over n square, the only contribution to the double discontinuity comes from the protected part of the correlator. So now you can ask yourself, okay, now I'm completely confused. You said that you would like to use the long part, why now the protected part comes about. It comes about because we also are inputting the fact that our full answer is crossing symmetric. Crossing symmetric means that we can exchange as we heard in the previous talk, we can take the OP into different orders and then this has to be associative, but the crossing symmetry needs to be applied. Let me just quickly go back to this function G here. So when we take the crossing symmetric part when we impose a crossing symmetry of our function, this function here, there is also this function that comes into play. So quite nicely, the double discontinuity is completely recovered by this protected part here. So in particular, as I said before, the only part of the function that can have a double discontinuity is objects which are logarithmic, and a single logarithm or single logarithm has a double discontinuity which is equal to zero, but higher logarithmic term, they have a double discontinuity which is different from zero, but terms of this form, they have a double discontinuity which is different from zero in a distributional sense. What that means, it means that by using the formula that I showed you previously, it is possible to completely determine without any ambiguity H0 and H1. So the minimum amount of information that we are inputting now is the protected part, and the fact that we have a double trace operator. So I'm inputting inside this relation this kind of expansion and the fact that I have a protected part. This is the minimum amount of information plus this formula that I showed you before. Now, when we would like to go at second order, so at order 1 over n^4, two things stop happening. The first thing is that the protected operator stop contributing. So this is just a fact. One can check that this is the case. So we are not doing any kind of approximation. And the second thing is that there will be a term, as I was trying to explain before, that has a logarithm square of u, which when we compute the crossing symmetry is translated to a logarithm log square of b. And this log square of b in front, if you go back to the previous slide, has a term which is a sum of a0, which is the leading OP coefficient, times the anomalous dimension at order 1 squared. Notice that here I wrote that h1 can be completely computed, so this means that one can completely also determine this gamma 1 here. So this contribution can be completely computed because A0 can be read off from H0 and gamma 1 can be read off from H1. So this sum here can be completely computed from previous order. So the contribution in front of this logarithm square can be completely computed. Now, this object has a double discontinuity which is different from zero. So, and it is the only term that has a double discontinuity which is different from zero. So by knowing this object here, we can completely determine what I called before C delta and L. And so it is possible with the minimum assumption, again, of knowing the fact that we have the dimension of the intermediate operator and the protected side that allowed us to compute this function here, it is possible to reconstruct completely the function at order n^-4. Notice that I'm skipping a difficulty a bit, but this difficulty can be overcome, so I don't want to spend a lot of time here, is the fact that there is some mixing problem. The mixing problem comes because there is more than one operator which has the same dimension as spin, because notice that again we can read off A0 and gamma 1 by the OP decomposition. So if inside the sum that I was showing previously there is more than one operator with the same dimension and the same spin, it's impossible to read off this function, but this mixing problem can be solved by enlarging, by computing more correlators, and the same things apply. So this is just a warning, but it is possible to completely solve the problem and reconstructing the full amplitude. And what happens is it is pretty nice. So we can compute this box function by just taking a copy twice a copy of the tree Witten diagram. So here, this is essentially, it's like taking this cut here and summing over all the possible gammas that appear inside of this object. This is essentially related to the fact, let me just go back here, that we have this gamma one squared. And the fact that we need to sum over all these possible p is due to the fact that we have this mixing problem that I was mentioning about. It means essentially that inside this loop here, there are not only gravitons, but there are also these Higer Kaluza-Klein modes. So in order to take into account that, we need to study also these correlators like O2, O2, OP, OP here. So this is completely solved. Now the question that I would like to, okay, this is just another comment about what I was discussing before. So the only cut that we can do here is a double trace cut. And we will see that this is not generic. So when we go higher at the loop order, this is not true any longer. This is the other thing that I would like to discuss. So another thing that we could think of doing, we can try to say, okay, now that we understood that this is the minimum amount of information that we need to have in order to reconstruct fully H2, now we can push our program farther and farther, and we can decide to compute the full all loop expansion. Now there are a few problems. In particular, there are two problems. The first one is that there will be higher trace operators that start contributing to the double discontinuity. So since this higher trace operator will start contributing, we need to study them as a side. And there is also another problem that there will be another mixing problem at higher order to be solved, meaning that there can be more operators that start mixing all together, and it's very complicated. I'm not even sure if this is completely possible to solve this the problem too. Now, despite these problems, there is a term which is completely determined, and this term is the higher the term which has the highest possible logarithm in U. And why this is possible to be solved? Because if you look at this, at the expansion, the previous expansion that I showed you before when n is very large, we see that actually this higher term in higher logarithm in U is multiplied by this function that we completely know. So we completely know this function because this corresponds to object that we can compute starting from the previous order. In particular, we can compute this from the leading term, from what I was calling H naught, and this we can compute from H1. So now, indeed, this does not exhaust the full amplitude, and in particular, it does not exhaust the full double discontinuity, but we can ask the question, to which part of the full answer this corresponds to? So if we would like to go to the loop diagram, to which part of the loop diagram this corresponds to? And in order to understand this, what we did, we computed this full sum that I was showing you before, meaning this object here. Then we take a specific limit, and this specific limit connects the correlator to the flat space amplitude, and then we compute the amplitude in flat space, and we compare these two limits, and then we said, okay, if this works in the flat space limit, since this function f of u and v takes into account also all the correction when we have the full ADS5 cross S5, then we can say that this works also for higher, for the curved space phase time. And the result, so I don't bother you with all the details, but the result is very interesting. And what it corresponds to, it corresponds to S channel consecutive cuts. So in particular, when we have any loop order, this box here, we can take this consecutive cut, which are still double trace cut, and this highest logarithmic cut corresponds to taking the full amplitude at any loop order that you like and performing this cut. This is very interesting, and it is very nice because, as I said, this can be said for any loop order, which with other methods, with Feynman diagram techniques, there is not at all any way of computing this object in a curved spacetime. And actually, this is a very nice starting point, for instance, if you would like to understand, to make an ansatz of all the possible functions that can appear, like a basis of function that can represent the string amplitudes at this order here. I think that I'm running out of time. I will just quickly mention one last thing, and then I will conclude. So, as I said before, let me maybe start from here. So those cuts are still double trace cut because these cuts are essentially determined by the fact that we know this A0 and gamma 1 of the double trace operator. But as I said, as soon as we go, for instance, we could have taken a cut here that would cut two boxes, and this the operator corresponding to this cut would have been higher trace operators. So in particular, we understand that very quickly higher trace operator would start contributing. And how can we think about them? So we started thinking, what is a way of understanding which kind, so how we can study this higher trace operator? One way that we studied is to understand how, again, to deal with this multi-trace operator is to start with a four-point correlator of higher trace operator. There is also another approach, which is going to higher points, but we didn't follow that road. So, in order to do so, one can start by studying correlator of quarter BPS operators, which are intrinsically double trace operator, but they are also protected. So they are the easiest possible four point function of double trace operators. And we did this study for this kind of operator that they transform under this SU4 representation. And we started studying correlators in this form. And in particular, I will just quickly scroll to this part just to say what we did. So what we managed to do, you can understand that this is a bit complicated because inside the OP of this object, which are these operators here, they start contributing tons of different polarization. But what we managed to do, we managed to disentangle the contribution of the protected operators inside the OP. So essentially we found some baby version of what I called the G-short before for this kind of object. And now we are trying to understand how to bootstrap this function here. So this is a project that we finished a few months back, and now we are trying to understand if it is possible to systematically study this correlator using this either trace operator, because then we can take this bit of information and inputting in the previous discussion that I said in order to completely reconstruct the amplitude. I didn't have time to discuss that, but let me just go to the conclusion. So what I hope that I show you is how to compute amplitudes in Karp spacetime, not doing Feynman diagrams, but to use the ADS-CFT correspondence, and in particular the CFT counterpart. And this method relies only on the symmetries. As I said, I didn't mention at all the action or anything like that. So it can be applied also for other versions of, for instance, ADS-CFT correspondence. I was discussing the ADS5 cross S5 string theory, but it can be done for other setup as well. And another interesting development that some groups are doing now is to take the results that one can get from integrability and complementing with this approach. This is very promising because with integrability we have a set of dimension and OP coefficient that can be inputted in this program and try to see how far we can go. So thank you very much for your attention, and sorry, maybe I was a few minutes late.
If there's one or two quick questions.
Very good. I have a question which is about, I'm David Berenstein, by the way. Is there any sense in which the Newton's law has been recovered by these methods, that, you know, we know how to do gravity at short distances in ADS?
In which sense do you mean Newton's law?
We're usually in ADS5 cross S5, so there's this certain sense in which we'd like to see gravity at sub-ADS scales. I mean, usually a lot of the bounds where people recover gravity are for very, very large angular momentum. Is there any sense in which we can now start seeing the other part?
I'm not 100% sure, because this is still supergravity. So we are in the supergravity regime in this way. So I think in order to answer this kind of question, one would start going like resumming this full lambda expansion. I think when you would do that, one maybe can start looking to, like I was discussing, there are only double trace operator when we take this specific limit. But if we start taking another effective theory in which a single trace would start appearing, this is a completely different discussion.
Right. Thank you.
Okay, so because sorry, I didn't manage. Oh, there's a question from somebody.
Yeah, can I ask a question?
Yes. Yes. Please quickly.
Hi, Anissa. That's a very nice talk. Do you have a comment about when is the first time the string states will start contributing at the loop? I mean, you discussed the contribution of multi-trays, but strings.
I think that we start contributing already to the very first order if we don't take lambda to be very large.
Oh, so, I see. That's how you. Oh, I see. I see.
So that would contribute already. So in particular, let me maybe be a bit more precise with that. So if we don't take I want to take another slide, sorry, just a second. So here, imagine that we would do that expansion in the curved space. When we would resum all this term here, we would get the contribution of the single trace as well. So we need to do the full expansion in alpha prime to see that there will be the single trace contributing. So in particular, we need to consider the full lambda expansion. Here I'm just showing the leading term. So, but at any order, they would contribute.
I mean, let's say if you look at the one loop answer, which was suppressed by, okay, 1/n^4 in your case, one could think of, you know, just a string stage going into the loop.
That appears
in lambda. So let's say if you do a lambda expansion, when would that start?
If you do a lambda expansion, they won't contribute because their mass is very, very high. So it scales, is not, as soon as you do as a lambda expansion, they won't contribute because they scale, their three-point function scale as 1/n^2. So we don't consider it. It will be of order, Heiniger order in n. So they won't contribute. And in particular, the dimension scale as square root of lambda. So it will be completely decoupled from this discussion here. But if you want to do an honest computation for any order of lambda, they will contribute very quickly.
Okay.
I'm not sure if I explain myself. No. Like if you go away from the supergravity approximation, they immediately contribute.
I mean, there will still be a limit where instead you have supergravity for the external states. And then it's, instance, the first string states start contributing in the loop. I understand what you're saying, the large lambda limit, of course, the dimension of string states go like square root of lambda. So they're very much suppressed. But I presume one can pinpoint the first time where a string state is going around the loop. I think I understood your answer. Yeah, thank you.
Okay.
Thank you very much, and let's thank the speaker again.